So today we have stepped into the last unit of this course on analog MOS circuit design, and that is on the frequency response of different types of MOS amplifiers, which we have discussed for the last few days. Now, so far, if we just once again recall what we have discussed in the last few units, starting with the device characteristics of the MOSFET, then I have discussed about the single stage and the multi-stage amplifier, MOS amplifier, and in which case the common source, common gate, and the common drain, each of them have been discussed. And I have also mentioned the cascode amplifier in particular. Then the differential amplifier, the utility of differential amplifier, and the advantage of that. And ultimately, in the last unit, I have talked about the current mirror circuit. But so far, I have not said anything regarding the frequency response of any amplifier circuit, particularly in this course. So whenever we have talked about any amplifier, as you know, but for the sake of completeness, I have to once again give you some brief idea regarding what is meant by the frequency response of any generic amplifier. So if I have an amplifier over here, let this amplifier be represented by some black box. And I'm modeling this amplifier as a two-port network. And suppose I'm providing some input over here, Vin, and I'll be getting some output over here, Vout. So far we are interested in calculating the voltage gain of the amplifier. And we have discussed different types of configuration of the amplifier, like a common source, common gate, common drain, and the relative advantages and disadvantages associated with each of these configurations. And particularly, we're interested in finding out the voltage gain, AV, which is nothing but the ratio of these two, Vout upon Vin. But while making this calculation using the small signal model, we have just neglected the any role of capacitance. In fact, if we just remember the small signal model for a MOS device, we do have the current source, voltage dependent current source, that is GMV1, and we do have R0, which is connected in between the drain and source terminal. And sometimes if I want to incorporate the body effect, then GMV times VP1. So that is the thing. So nothing else was introduced in this particular case. But remember, whenever we talk about the amplifier, we are not at all interested, or not only we're interested in knowing the gain of the amplifier, that is AV, the input impedance, output impedance, but also we are very much interested in knowing the speed limitation of the amplifier circuit. That means whenever I provided some input like this, suppose it is like a sinusoidal signal, and let me represent the sinusoidal signal like Vin is equal to some A0, say cos of omega naught t like this, or cos of omega t, I can say. Now, considering this as the input, we have calculated the corresponding gain, but we have never changed the frequency of this particular signal. The sinusoidal signal frequency was kept at a very small value. So in a nutshell, we can say that we have basically derived the voltage gain for the low frequency response. When the value of this frequency, I can always represent this like in Hertz frequency, it can be represented like A0 cos twice by F0. Where F0 is the Hertz frequency, and that frequency was very small, in the range of say a few kilohertz to say a few hundreds of kilohertz, not that large. So that there are different capacitance within the MOS device, and the impact of those capacitances were negligible, were neglected. But as soon as we make any attempt to increase the frequency in order to understand the speed limitation of the circuit, whether the circuit is suffering from any speed limitation, the amplifier circuit is suffering from any speed limitation or not, so we have to increase the frequency, this Hertz frequency. So initially we have started with some kilohertz or hundreds of kilohertz, then we have to just we have to just change this F0, so it should be varied. So from kilohertz to hundreds of kilohertz, and hundreds of kilohertz to megahertz, and megahertz to hundreds of megahertz, and we have to increase the frequency, the Hertz frequency, and we have to check whether there is any significant difference in the output, whether the same gain is maintained or not. And the thing is that whenever you make any attempt to increase the signal frequency at the input side, so there are different capacitances which were initially there inside the MOS device, but initially the impact of those capacitances were neglected because the frequency was very small. So you know the impedance provided by the capacitance is given by 1 upon omega c. So for a small frequency, if omega is very small, so then this particular capacitance value is pretty large. And since you will gradually see that these capacitances are coming in shunt path, in parallel path, so therefore for very small frequency, in the order of say few tens of kilohertz, you can just neglect these capacitances, the impact of those capacitances, because they are coming in shunt and they are having very high value, so you can simply neglect them initially for very low frequency. But as soon as you make any attempt to increase the frequency, then obviously you have to take into account those capacitances, and accordingly we do have some RC kind of network, and we have to find out the frequency response of the circuit. How does the circuit behave? How does the amplifier circuit behave when you just change the input signal frequency? So that is all about the frequency response, and I hope that you have sufficient knowledge of frequency response from your understanding in electronic circuits. Now let us now very quickly, I think this is a basic understanding about the frequency response. Now very quickly, let me just go into the MOS device. I mean, I can just simply draw the cross-sectional diagram of the MOS device, and then you can identify the different capacitance which are initially there, and what are those capacitances, and how to incorporate their effect in the circuit. Now let me just consider a simple NMOS, N-type MOSFET, which is fabricated on a P-type substrate. Now I do have the drain and the source terminal. So as you know, these are N plus, and you do have some oxide layer on the top of that, and above the oxide layer there is a polysilicon gate, polysilicon layer, and the gate connection is obtained from this. So this is the gate terminal, as you know. And accordingly, you have this is the, suppose, the source terminal, and this is the drain terminal. And the substrate is normally grounded. So that is all about the cross-sectional view. And while calculating the expression for the drain current ID, you have perhaps come across one term which is known as the COX, that is the offset capacitance per unit area. So what is the capacitance? That means whenever you do have a situation like this, your metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, so obviously you do have an oxide layer in a MOSFET, and because of that, this oxide capacitance you have to take into account. Now whenever I do have a MOS symbol in a circuit like this, so let me just consider this one. So you do have a gate terminal, you do have a drain terminal, you do have a source terminal. So initially, we have seen that in the expression of the drain current, we do have some COX, that is offset capacitance per unit area. But whenever we talk about the circuit like this, or device like this, embedded into a MOS amplifier circuit, then ultimately you do have only three terminals. You do have a gate terminal, you do have a drain, and you do have a source. Now COX is the capacitance, the oxide capacitance per unit area. Now you have to decompose this oxide capacitance between gate to source and gate to drain. So ultimately you do have between these two layer, I mean between these two terminal, gate and source, gate and source and gate and drain, you do have two capacitance. One is known as the CGS, that is the capacitance connected between the gate and source, and the second capacitance between gate and drain. Remember, these are not externally connected, but because of the implication of the device, these are the internal capacitance, as you understand from your knowledge in BJT as well. So you do have CGS and CGT. So this COX, this total oxide capacitance, COX multiplied with W into L, because COX is measured per unit area, and when it is multiplied with W and L, then it will give you the total oxide capacitance. And then it is decomposed into two lumped capacitors. One is CGS, which was connected between the, or which was there in between the gate and source, and the second capacitor, which was there in between the gate and drain. Now, apart from these two capacitors, now you have to take a look at this 2-PN junction. Now, you do have an N plus source and N plus drain, and you do have a P-type substrate over here. So basically, it forms a diode. It forms a diode, a P-N junction diode, and preferably it is reverse bias. And automatically, since we have a P-N junction diode with reverse bias condition, so obviously you do have another junction capacitance. So the junction capacitance exists between the source to the substrate and the drain to the substrate. So basically, you do have, I can always regard this as a diode. And this gives rise to two capacitance. One is CSB. So B stands for the bulk. So I'm not intentionally, I'm not using the term substrate, because if you have source and if you have substrate, then it can be confusing to some extent. So in the literature also, you will find that this capacitance is known as CSB, that is the capacitance between source and the bulk. And this is known as the CDB, that is the capacitance between the drain and the bulk. So practically speaking, these are the four capacitances, CGS, CGD, CSB, and CDB, which are there. And in some other circuits, whenever you are going to design some P-type of MOSFET on an well, N well, then between the substrate and the well, there can be some another capacitance which is connected between the bulk and the well. So this is known as a CBW. And for the short channel devices, whenever the distance between these two, I mean this drain and source, so when this distance, the channel distance is very small, for short channel devices, you will find another capacitance which is there, that is the drain to source capacitance. But this drain to source capacitance is very much pertinent in case of short channel devices. But as long as we are interested in a long channel device, then we can simply neglect this drain to source capacitance. So ultimately, we do have four types of capacitance. Of one is this CGS, which is connected between, or which is existing between gate and source terminal. Then we have the CGD, gate and drain, and these two junction capacitance, CSB and then CDB. So these are the four capacitance. Now, sometimes you know that you have also seen that impact while studying the BJT amplifiers, that some of the capacitances, they are connected between the input terminal and the output terminal. Then automatically, you have to face some problem in calculating the frequency response of those amplifier circuits. And then we have to take the help of a very useful theorem in circuit theory, which is known as the Miller effect. So although it has been already discussed in electronic circuits course, but still for the sake of completeness and for your understanding, let me once again give you a brief recapitulation what you have discussed in Miller effect. So very briefly, I can tell you that you do have an amplifier over here represented by means of black box, and which is having a gain of say A. The two-port network, suppose V1 is the input potential, V2 is the output potential, and suppose some impedance is connected. So some impedance is connected between the input and the output. Let this impedance be represented by Z. So I'm not going into the mathematical calculation. Let this impedance be represented by Z. Then what is the effective impedance as seen at the input side? The effective impedance, Z effective, as seen in the input side, as you can remember, this is basically given by Z upon 1 minus A. And if I just consider the effective impedance, looking at the, or what I can do is, I can just write G effective looking at the input side, and Z effective looking at the output side. And that was nothing but Z upon 1 minus A inverse. So these are the two effective impedance, and we have to take the help of this Miller theorem, Miller effect, in this calculation as well. And remember, whenever you talk about the impedance, it is nothing but Z upon 1 minus A. But for capacitance, as you have already mentioned in the electronic circuits course, that for capacitance, whenever you have capacitance, you know the Z for any capacitance, the impedance is given by 1 upon S multiplied with C. So therefore, in order to take into account the Miller effect, the effective capacitance, the input side, is nothing but 1 minus A times the actual value of the capacitance. And similarly, the output side, it was given by 1 minus A inverse multiplied with C. So this is a brief recapitulation of Miller effect. So let me just write down the name of the theorem, which is very popular. And it is extensively used in finding out the corresponding frequency response of a small signal amplifier. And you have already seen its impact in BJT amplifiers. Now, with this understanding, let us now, first of all, go into the simplest model of a MOS amplifier. So what I am saying, a common source amplifier, and you have to identify. So let me start with the common source CS amplifier. And let us first of all try to identify the different capacitors which are there in the circuit and how are they present. Now, for a CS amplifier, I can start with a resistive kind of loop, that is RD. I think it will be better if I just draw in that side only, because I have to once again incorporate another such CS amplifier. So let me just show you. So this is the supply line, that is VDD. Then you have this one, NMOS device. Now the input is applied over here at the gate terminal, and we are taking the output from this terminal. This is the drain resistance RD, and you have VDD over here, that is the supply, and you are taking the output from this terminal, and the input is provided at this terminal. So this is the very simplest model of common source amplifier involving this MOS device, and we have only one resistance right now at this moment. Now you have to identify the different capacitors which are there, and which will play a pivotal role in controlling the frequency operation, or the highest frequency operation of this amplifier circuit. So as I've already mentioned, if you just once again go into the last slide here, already there are, I mean, so I have not mentioned these two. So apart from that, we do have like this capacitor, so I should complete this one. So you have this capacitance, which is connected between the source and the body or bulk, and this one is the CDB. So now, out of these four capacitors, now you have to place this capacitance in this circuit here itself. So you can simply identify the different nodes. This is the gate node, gate terminal. This is the drain terminal. This is the source terminal. Source is grounded here, and so as the body or bulk. So first of all, you have to connect one capacitance which is there in between the gate and the source terminal. In fact, this is a parasitic capacitance, so it is not externally connected, as I mentioned several times. So this capacitance, so this is the CGS, which is there in between the gate and source. Then you do have the capacitance between the gate and the drain. So let me just consider that. Okay, let me just redraw this one. So this is the so this one is CGD, as it is called, between gate and drain. This is connected, and then obviously between drain to bulk we do have one capacitor, CDB. So I may call like CDB, drain and bulk or body. And then between source and the body, we have another capacitor between the source and the body, which is known as CSB. Now, first of all, having considered those, having drawn these four different capacitors, now you have to identify whether any of the capacitors is redundant. So first of all, this particular judgment, you have to check the two nodes of the capacitor. Now, for CGS, you find that one node is connected to the gate terminal, at which terminal you are providing the input, and the other node is at the source end, for CDB, one node is at the output end and the other one is to AC ground. And for CGD, one node is at the input side and another node is at the output side. However, for CSB, as you find, one node, I mean, if you just consider one terminal is at source and the other terminal is at bulk, and both of them are at AC ground. Therefore, we can simply just neglect this capacitance because both of the two terminals, they are connected to the same point, that is the ground, AC ground. So we can simply neglect this capacitance and it will not play any role in controlling the frequency operation for this common source amplifier. And out of these three capacitors, as we have marked over here, CGS, CGD, and CDB, you find that CGD is that particular capacitor for which the Miller effect is significant, because this is connected between the input and the output terminal. Because CGD is always connected between the gate and the drain. And for common source amplifier, you have this gate terminal is the input terminal and drain terminal is the output terminal. So therefore, whenever we draw the small signal equivalent circuit, then obviously the impact of CGD has to be seen under the purview of Miller effect. So that is fine. Now we can simply modify this common source amplifier to some extent, in the sense that we can simply substitute this resistance, this drain resistance RD, by means of a current source load. So already you know that we have discussed this one, that we can simply substitute this resistance, this discrete resistance, by means of a current source load, and you know the advantage of having lesser voltage headroom. So if I want to do that, then obviously I require two such MOS device, one for the load and the other one for the input. So the upper one acting as a current source load, and the lower one is known as input device. So it's same, that is the common source amplifier. So once again, we should apply the input at the gate, and we will be taking the output from this end, that is Vout. And since it is acting as a current source, so I can provide some constant potential VB over here. And this is the drain supply, that is VDD. And let me call this as M1, this as M2, the naming. Now, for this particular circuit, you have to identify the different capacitors which are there. So first of all, if I just consider this one, the first MOS, that is M1. So there are four capacitors in fact. So the first one is between the gate and the source of the first MOS. So I can call it like CGS1. And the second one is obviously this one, that is in between the gate and the drain, that is CGD1. And from the drain terminal to AC ground, I do have CDB, CDB1, drain to bulk or drain to body, and obviously this one between source to bulk. So for the, so this one is CSB1. So for the first MOS, you do have four such capacitors which are shown in this figure. Now you have to consider the second MOS, that is, which is acting as a load over here. So similarly, here also you have to identify the terminals. So as you know, this is the source terminal because it's a PMOS. So this is the source terminal. Source is connected to drain supply, and here's the gate, and this is the drain of the second MOS. So here also you will find this is the. So now this one is the gate to drain, right? So this is CGD2. Gate to drain, and this one is the gate to source capacitance, gate to source capacitance for the second MOS, CGS2. Now here you do have from this terminal, this is the drain 2 of MOS 2. So obviously you do have one capacitor, that is CDB2, drain to bulk. And from here, so this is the source terminal, you do have one capacitor, and which is equal to CSB2, source to bulk. So out of these eight capacitors, now you have to identify whether there are any redundant capacitance present. And if some capacitance is there in the circuit whose role is insignificant during the analysis of the circuit. So we have to ignore or we have to neglect those capacitors. So the same process you have to apply. So as you find this CSV1, like before, so both of the plates, they're having the same potential, AC ground and AC ground. So obviously, this is not required, simply thrown away. And whatever the other one is, any other, the CGD1, we have to take it, CDB1, fine. And then you have to take a look at this CSB2. So this is AC ground, because this is connected to the drain supply, that is VDD. So VDD is AC ground, and this is also AC ground. Therefore, the CSB2 is not required, right? And what about CGS2? Just take a look that both of these two terminals, they're having constant potential, VB here and VDD here. So no small signal variation. Both of them are having constant potential. So for CGS2, whenever you draw the small signal equivalent circuit, you'll find that both of these two terminals are having AC ground. So obviously, CGS2 is also not required. So although we do have eight such capacitors in the initial circuit, and now we can get rid of three capacitors, this, this, and this. So that is one thing, we can get rid of some capacitors during AC analysis. And then we have to check whether we can simply merge some of the capacitance or not. That is also important. Can we merge some of the capacitance? So for merging, we have to check whether there are any such capacitances which are there in shunt path, in parallel path. Then we can simply add them together. So now you just take a look over here at this terminal and output node. You would have CDB1. CDB1 is present between the output terminal to the AC ground. That is one capacitor. What about CDB2? CDB2 is also there between the output terminal and the AC ground, right? And the last one, this one, CGD2. This is connected between this output terminal and VB. So obviously, as you understand, VB is at AC ground in the small signal equivalent circuit. So therefore, all these three capacitors, these three can be taken together. I'm just putting a dot. So all these three can be taken together, and they can be equivalently represented by one capacitor connected between this point to ground, between this point to ground. So let me just show you. I think what I can do is, I can show it over here only. So in fact, this is a C dashed. This is effective capacitance, and this effective capacitance C dashed is nothing but, since the capacitors are there in the parallel path, so the effective capacitance will be just simply the addition. So CDB1 plus CDB2 plus you have CGD2. So this is it. So now, although we have started with eight such capacitors, now we are left with only these three together, three, four, five capacitors only. So if the number of capacitors are reduced, then it will help us in solving the small signal equivalent circuit in an elegant way. And more capacitance are there in the circuit, then it will make the circuit, I mean, it will make the analysis much more complex. And then the other thing is that whether the Miller effect is present over here or not. So to understand that, you have to once again take a look at the input terminal, output terminal. So input is here, output is here. So CGD1, like before, CGD1 is the capacitance for which the Miller effect is persistent. So obviously, while calculating the small signal gain, you have to find out the equivalent capacitance at the input node and the output node for CGD1 only. So that is the scenario for a common source kind of amplifier. Now, what we can do is we can very briefly take a look at the common drain and the common gate kind of thing. What happens for common drain for source follower, as you know? So common drain, as you know, common drain amplifier, or also known as source follower. So common drain amplifier. So once again, as you know, for common drain amplifier, the input is applied at the gate terminal, and the output is obtained at the source terminal. So let me start with the common drain amplifier. So the drain terminal is connected to the VDD that is supplied. And this is VDD. And we are providing the input over here. Let me just, So this is the input MOS. This is the input MOS. So we are applying input over here, and we are supposed to get the output at this particular point. And obviously, there are certain load element some load resistances here, and we can also implement the load resistance by means of a current source kind of stuff. So then what you can do is we can simply represent the load by means of a current source kind of thing. So you do have this MOS which is acting as a load, and for which the gate potential is say VB, that is a constant potential. So this is the drain supply VDD, and we are taking the output from this. As you understand, it's a source follower, so it will just follow the, I mean the source will follow the corresponding gate potential. So input is over here, output is over here, and this is the input MOS, and which is acting as the input device, an amplifying device M1, and this one M2 will be acting as the load device. So like before, we have to identify the capacitors. So first of all, for this one, for this input MOS, we do have this gate to source capacitors, which is there in between the gate and source of the first MOS, and obviously the gate to drain CGD1. From drain to bulk, you do have CDB1, and from source to bulk, you do have another capacitor, that is CSB1. So this is all about the upper MOS, that is M1. Similarly, we have to identify the corresponding capacitors for the load, that is MOS2, M2. So we do have CGS2, we do have CGD2, then obviously this one, which is nothing but CDB2, and this one, CSB2. Now, out of this eight, once again, we do have eight capacitors. Now we have to get rid of some capacitors which are not required at all. What are those capacitors? Obviously, you should, you must agree that the CSB, it should be ignored. Apart from that, we should also ignore CGS2 because this point is at VB. So VB means AC ground. This is also AC ground. So we can get rid of this capacitor, that is CGS2. It will not be having any effect on the small signal analysis, and obviously this is CDB1 because VDD and ground, so CDB1 we have to get rid of that. So out of these eight capacitors, already we have ignored these three, and can we just merge some of the capacitors? Now if you want to merge some of the capacitors, then first of all you have to identify those capacitors which can be merged together. So once again, if I just consider this output terminal over here, then let me once again mark with a pointer. Yeah, CDB2, this one, output to ground, CSB1, output to ground, and this one, this CGD2, output to AC ground. So I can simply have one capacitor in place of these three. So that is once again connected. I don't find space anyway. So it will be something like that. So C dashed. So C dashed is connected between the output node and the ground, and this is nothing but, I think it will be better if I just place it over here. So C dashed is given by the summation of three capacitors, that is CSB1 plus CDB2 plus CGD2. So once again, we are left with only three capacitors. So one capacitor is C dashed, and one capacitor is CGS1, and the other capacitor is CGD1. So CGS1, CGD1, and C dashed. So these are the three capacitors. And once again, you have to identify this CGS1 as a capacitor for which the Miller effect will be prevalent, because one terminal is at the input side, and another terminal for CGS1 is at the output side. So Miller effect, but as you understand, for a common drain or source follower circuit, the voltage gain is pretty small. In fact, it is less than one. So you don't find a Millard magnification over here, but still you do have to apply this Millard theorem only on this capacitor, that is CGS1, because one terminal is at the input and the other terminal is at the output. Well, so now with common drain, now only one topology is left, and that is common gate kind of amplifier, CG, common gate amplifier. Let us try to first find out the different capacitors which are there and how are they connected. And then obviously we will be one by one deliberately obtaining the corresponding transfer function of each of these configuration. And apart from that, we should also consider the cascode kind of thing and a differential pair as well. For a common gate, as you know, the input is applied at the source terminal and you collect the output at the drain end. The gate is considered to be at AC ground. So to start with, we can have a drain resistance over here. And this is the MOS, active MOS, for which the gate is held at a constant potential, that is, say, let it be VB. And suppose we are providing the output, we are providing the input at this terminal, at this end. So we'll be providing the input at this end. So VIN is connected at this end, and obviously there could have been some resistance over here through which this is connected. So I can simply show it. So just like this, can be connected. And we should collect the output from this end. So this is the output node. V out, this one is RD, and this is the drain supply. I'll call this MOS as the MOS one. So now, if I simply represent the load as a simple a discrete resistance, and obviously I'm not considering another MOS over here, but you know, if I want to replace this device, this resistance by means of another MOS, then you know how to incorporate the different capacitance over here. Anyway, so for this topology only, one second, we have to identify the different capacitors. So first one, the first is this one, which is connected between the gate and the source, that is CGS1. Then between the gate and the drain, that is CGD1. From the drain terminal, we should have one capacitor, that is CDB1. And from source to bulk, you should have another one, that is CSP1. So these are the four capacitors over here. If I want to represent RD as a simply RD. Now you have to understand whether any of the capacitors can be thrown away or not. Now for this, you have to check the potential. I mean, CGD1 cannot be neglected, CDB1 as well, CSB1 as well. So none of the capacitors can be neglected, cannot be thrown away. So all four capacitors will be there, CGD1, CGS1, CSB1, and CDB1 for this configuration of common gate. And what about the merging? Can you simply merge some of the capacitors? Is it possible? Yes or no? Yeah. So now if you just take a look over here, you will see that what are the different capacitors, so which you can simply merge them. So there are two different merging takes place. So first one is this one, the CGS1 and CSB1. So they can be merged together because they are sharing a common terminal, that is the source terminal, and the other end is grounded, that is AC ground. So I can share these two together. So you do have a situation like this. Instead of these two, you will have a situation like this. So I may call this like C dashed, where C dashed is equal to CGS1 plus CSB1, right? And we do have another situation, this one, CGD1 and CDB1. So once again, they are sharing a common terminal, that is the drain terminal, output terminal, and the other end is grounded. So now we can also merge these two together, and I can simply have a capacitance like this. Let me call this like C double last. So C double last is equal to CGD1 plus CDB1. So now you are having a common gate amplifier with only two effective capacitance, one is C dash and second one is C double last. So lower is the number of the capacitors in the circuit, better is the convenience of analyzing the circuit, because if you have more number of capacitors in the circuit, then it will make your calculation much more difficult and complicated. So it will be better if it is possible, if the circuit topology allows you to simplify the model to some extent, to simplify the small signal equivalent circuit, then always do that. And if possible, if some of the capacitors are not required, then you can simply ignore them. And if some of the capacitors can be merged together, you can do that, so that the calculation can be made pretty simple. But right at this moment, I would like to mention one point, that although for a common source kind of amplifier, I mentioned that this source to bulk capacitor can be just simply thrown away. But remember, if I have, instead of having this type of configuration, if I do have one source degeneration, if I have a resistance like a resistance RS over here, then obviously you cannot simply ignore this CSP, right? Because in this particular case, when you have considered some fundamental common source amplifier with its source grounded, then only you can simply neglect this CSP. So it is not generic that whenever you find a common source amplifier, you can always ignore this CSP. It is not like that. So if you have a different circuit, then you have to apply your intuition, and accordingly, you have to first of all identify the capacitors which are present between the terminals CGD, CGS, CGS, CDB, CSB. You have to identify those capacitors, and depending upon the potential, because different circuits are having different type of configurations, and so you have to identify whether any of the capacitors can be thrown away or not. So there is no such hard and fast rule that whenever you do have a common source amplifier, the CSB will be neglected always. It's not like that. If I have a source degeneration over here, then obviously you cannot simply neglect this one, because that time the source end is not grounded, right? So then you cannot simply neglect CSP. So that is the thing that I want to mention over here. Now, with this basic understanding of the capacitors of the MOS device, now we are in a position, hopefully, to analyze the frequency response of these different stages, like common source, common gate, and common drain, one by one, obviously. So to start with, I can tell you one thing, that this frequency response analysis can be carried out from by two different aspects. One is the very straightforward aspect, that is you do have one common source amplifier like this. Suppose this is the amplifier you do have at your end, and once you have this circuit at your disposal, then you can simply draw the corresponding small signal equivalent model, and this time you have to incorporate all those capacitors, because it's not a low frequency model, because you have a high frequency model, and you have to incorporate those capacitors like CGD, CGS, CDB, and so on. And then if it is required, then you apply the Miller theorem, Miller effect, and accordingly you just simply try to find out the V out by V in, that is the gain from this point to this point, this gate to drain, what is the gain provided by this common source amplifier. I mean, from input to the output. For common source stage, it is between gate to drain, but for other type of configuration, it will be different. So simply you just find out V out by V in as a function of the frequency, that is the transfer function, V out S by V in S. And from that, you just try to draw the corresponding variation of this voltage gain with respect to the frequency. So that is a very straightforward approach, and it requires, tremendous mathematical calculation it requires, because as you understand, there are lots of capacitors, lots of resistances are there, and you do have, if I want to replace RD by means of one MOS, then you have to identify the corresponding equivalent circuit for the MOS, and that you have to incorporate over there. So the overall calculation will be pretty difficult, pretty tedious to do. So that is one thing, but if you just follow that approach, then it will give you some exact result, exact value for V out upon V, that is the transfer function. So that is one approach. We will follow that one. And there is another approach, another easy approach. And that approach is obtained from the intuition. Now the intuition says that whenever you do have a circuit like this, then you have to identify the different nodes in the circuit, and you have to find out the corresponding time constant associated with each node. Because as you know, the time constant and the frequency, they are simply inversely related. If a circuit is having a very low value of time constant, if RC time constant is small, then obviously it can respond faster, and vice versa. So accordingly, if I have a circuit like this, so after you draw the small signal model, or even without drawing the small signal model, you can simply identify the different nodes, and accordingly you have to find out the corresponding the frequency, the corresponding time constant associated with each of the nodes. Now, how to find out the time constant? As you know, time constant is nothing but 1 upon, the frequency is nothing but 1 upon this RC multiplied with 1 upon 2 pi. If I would like to find out the hertz frequency corresponding to any particular time constant, so that will give you like 1 by twice pi RC. So you have to do that. You have to do that exercise for all such nodes. Now, how to find out this R and C? Now, in the signal path, you have to find out this R and C just by making all the independent sources inactive, by making all of them zero. So if you have some voltage source over here, you have to make it zero. You have some current source over here, you have to make it zero. And then you find out the effective value of the resistance from this node to the ground, and the effective value of the capacitance from this node to the ground. Suppose I am interested in that particular node, that is input node, and I would like to find out the time constant at this particular node. So how to find out the time constant? So time constant is obtained like one upon time constant is nothing but R into C, and this R is nothing but the effective value of the resistance from this node to the ground, and the C is the effective value of the capacitance from this node to the ground. And once you get this R and C individually, you can simply have a product of that R into C, and 1 upon twice pi RC will give you the corresponding frequency, and which is known as the pole frequency. And accordingly, for the input side, you can find out one input pole. Similarly, the output side, you can find another output pole. And once you get this one, the input pole and the output pole, then you can make an approximate expression for the transfer function. So that can be written like, so I can tell you the approximate value for this transfer function. So this H of S, so this one is like, so I can just make it like some A naught. So A naught is the zero frequency or the low frequency gain divided by, so let me call that the time constant associated with this one, or the pole frequency associated with this one is say omega p1, and the pole frequency associated with this one is omega p2. Then I can simply write this by 1 plus s by omega p1 into 1 plus s by omega p2. And accordingly, you can have some overall understanding about how does the circuit behave. So it will not give you some exact result, unlike the small signal analysis, as we are accustomed to do. The small signal analysis, the detailed analysis, it will give you the exact expression for the HS, but it will give you some rough calculation or rough estimation about the nature of the frequency response. How does it behave, or how does it change with the variation of the frequency? So if I have, two node frequency like this, we have like omega p1 and omega p2. These are the two pole frequencies. Then this approximately H of S can be represented by this A0, which is the zero frequency response, as we can simply verify from the expression itself. Because if you put S is equal to zero in this expression, or S very small with respect to omega p1 and omega p2, then the denominator can be approximated to one, and H of S turns out to be A naught. So A naught is the zero frequency and low frequency gain of the circuit. And if I have some omega P1, the corresponding pole frequency, so this can be represented like, H of S can be written like this one. But this will give you some erroneous result, some approximate result, I should say. But roughly, if I would like to know what about the overall behavior of the circuit, how does the circuit behave with the variation of the frequency, that will be obtained directly from this particular expression. Anyway, so we will follow each of these two approaches, and we will see that where are the errors, and what is the reason behind this error. Now to start with, let me just consider once again the small signal model, and which will give us some exact calculation or exact value for the frequency response. So obviously we have to start with simply a common source kind of thing. So let me just first draw the circuit. So that is very important. You have to draw the circuit first. So a common source stage. And suppose the signal source, let us consider that the signal source is not ideal. So it is having some source resistance associated with that. But even if the signal source is ideal, remember that sometimes we are not at all interested in knowing the behavior of a single stage circuit. Sometimes we are pretty much interested in knowing the multi-stage, the frequency response of a multi-stage amplifier, in which case this particular stage is preceded by some other stage. So in that case, the output impedance of the last stage is also getting reflected over here. So even if the signal source is ideal, so that resistance, what I am mentioning over here, what I am putting it over here, so you can also regard this resistance as the output impedance of the previous stage. So let me call this as Vin. That is input applied. And let me call this as the resistance, that is RG. And this is the drain resistance, a load resistance. And this is supply. And we'll be taking the output from this terminal, that is Vout. And now this is the circuit itself. Now we have already calculated the small signal gain for this circuit. And frankly speaking, the value is given by minus gm times rd, a very well-known and popular expression for the voltage gain. There is a phase reversal from input side to the output side, and the magnitude is given by gm times rd, roughly. So now whenever we do the high frequency analysis, so obviously we have to incorporate the different capacitors. So now it's time to insert those capacitors. I can simply ignore this source to bulk capacitors because it will not be there in the circuit because the source is grounded directly. So I can get rid of that capacitor. But I do have, apart from this, I do have two capacitors. One is between the gate to source, that is CGS. And this one between gate to drain, that is CGD. And obviously this capacitor between the drain terminal and the bulk, that is CDV. So these are the three capacitors, and which are playing important role in controlling the corresponding frequency response of the overall amplifier. Now with this understanding, what we can do is we can simply draw the small signal model incorporating those capacitors. Now to start with, let me start from this point. So we do have input signal, that is Vin. And let me have this RG. And at this point, you have the capacitor, that is CGS, between this end to ground. So this is CGS. So this is the gate terminal. Now, let me call that this voltage here is V1. And we do have this one, voltage dependent current source, which is GM times V1. And CDV, that capacitor, you have to insert over here. So right now I'm just not considering the output impedance, the output resistance of the MOS device, that is R0. I'm just assuming that R0 is pretty large. So that's why it is not there. So CDV. And obviously, this RD. If you wish, you can also place it over here. So that is RD between drain and the ground, because source is grounded. And if you wish, you can also incorporate R0 over here. Then instead of having RD, you can have like RD or like R dashed is equal to RD parallel R0. So it does not change the calculation. Now, only one capacitor we have not mentioned over yet, that is CGD. So that is connected between the gate and the drain, and for which the Miller effect is there. That is CGD. CGD. And we are taking the output from this end, that is V out. And this is grounded. So that is all about the small signal equivalent circuit incorporating the capacitors. Now what we can do is I can call this node as input node. Let me call this node as node X and this node as node Y. And we have to apply Kirchhoff's current law, that is KCL, both at node X and node Y to find out the expression for the voltage gain. So now if I just apply KCL at node X, KCL at X, what you're getting. So now if I assume that all the currents are leaving, then we do have V1 minus V in upon RG plus for this one, we do have V1, and for this capacitor CGS, the impedance is given by 1 upon SCGS. So V1 upon 1 upon SCGS will give you V1 times SCGS. And plus, what about this? It's nothing but V1 minus V out. So effective voltage is V1 minus V out. And then it should be multiplied with SCGD. That is equal to zero. That is one thing. And if you apply KCL at node Y, KCL at node Y, then getting, once again, I'm assuming that all the currents are leaving. So here you'll find that the current that is leaving is nothing but V out minus V1. V out minus V1. Minus V1 into SCGD. Plus you have this current that is GM times V1. And then you have V out and then these two impedances, one upon RD plus SCDV. That is equal to zero. So these are the two equations. Now we have to find out the relation between V in and V out. So we have to somehow substitute V1 with respect to V out. And so what we can do is we can take V1 in one side. So we do have V1. So from this expression itself, so there's a little bit mathematics over here. So V1, if I take V1 common, GM minus S CGD. So that is equal to, I can take V out in that side. So minus V out. Then you have 1 upon RD plus S CDB plus S CGD. That is, so I can write V1 is equal to, so V1 is equal to minus V out upon GM minus SCGD into, we do have like RD inverse plus SCDB plus SCGB. CGD, sorry. CGD. It looks like B, but there is no capacitor over there. So CGD, fine. So V1 is equal to this one. So now with this, I can simply substitute V1 in equation number one over here. So now let me just, what I can do is we can, this can be copied. What can I be copied to internet? Anyway, so let me just once again write down the expression for, I mean, what was there? The expression was V1 minus V in by RG. So V1 into SCGD plus SCGS. So V1 into SCGD plus SCGS. And we do have 1 upon RG plus 1 upon RG. Or I can write like RG in watts. That is equal to V in by RG and V out into SCGD. So that is equal to V in by RG plus V out in SCGD into SCGD. That's great. Now we have to put the hello V on over here. What we have got, V1 is equal to minus V out by GMSCGD. So V1, we have got like minus V out upon GM minus SCGD. Then we have RD inverse SCD V SCGD. RD inverse plus SCGB plus SCDB. And that is all about V1. Well, so that has to be present over here. So I'm just going to substitute V1. So now I'm having minus V out. Now we have two expression in the numerator, RD inverse plus SCGB plus SCDB multiplied with RG inverse plus SCGD plus SCGS. Now divided by GM minus SCGD. That is equated to V in by RG plus V out into SCGD. Well, so now what I can do is I can take V out in one side and V in the other side. So better I can keep V in the left hand side. So then it will be like minus V in upon RG. That is equal to V out. If I take V out common, then what is left? SCGD. And this entire thing in the right hand side. So we do have these two factor, RD inverse plus SCGB plus SCDB. In fact, this equation, I mean, this calculation is pretty lengthy. So that's why people are interested in finding out the expression or to understand the behavior of the circuit just by knowing the poles. So CGS is over, and you have GM minus SCGD. Not so, maybe. Anyway, so what I can do is now I can multiply. I mean, RG can be multiplied directly. And another thing is that I can multiply the numerator and denominator with RT. So then you have minus Vin in the left hand side because I'm multiplying this one with RC. And another thing is that, tilted. So I'm just multiplying over here SCGD with RD. So now here you have SCGD simply. So it will be multiplied with GM minus S CGD that gets multiplied with RD into SCGD. RD into SCGD into, I think we have another RG also. So let me just check. I'm just multiplying this with GM minus SCGD into SCGD. First, let me just make it like SCGD, yes. Then RD into RG. And then you have to multiply this one with RD and multiply this one with RG. So then you have 1 plus RD or SRD into CGB plus CDB. Multiplied with 1 plus SRG multiplied with CGB plus CGS. So it gets complicated. Anyway, so now we are almost towards the end because we have got like Vin as a function of Vout. So what I can do is Vout upon Vin. So this this thing is in the denominator here, so it goes up in the numerator side, and this entire expression will come to the denominator. So what we can find, V out upon V in, what I'm looking at, V out upon V in. So obviously we do have started with some minus sign. Minus, then you have this GM minus SCG into RD. GM minus, so numerator is having only one term, like GM minus SCGD into RD. That's all about the numerator. And in the denominator, we do have various things that we have to take into account. So I think we have started with some minus S square. So that is not at all desirable. We'll start with minus S. Let me check whether there is any error in the calculation. Let me once again check it. No, I think it's fine. Okay, let me just complete this denominator. What we have in the denominator, we have the first term is like GM RD RG SCGD, right? So the first term is GM RD RG SCGD. Then you have a minus. I think this minus gets cancelled. So minus SCGD whole square, S square CGD square RD RG. S square CGD square RD RG. Minus S square CGD square RD RG. Okay. Then we have this factor. So obviously we have one. I think it will be better if I just write it down. 1 plus SRT into CGB plus CDB plus 1 plus SRT CGB plus CDB. It gets multiplied with 1 plus SRG CGB CGS. 1 plus SRG CGB CGS. 1 plus SRG CGB plus CGS. So that is the entire thing. So I think now it can be simplified. So CM CGD and we have RT over here anyway. So now if I just start with this term, so what do we have? We have a square RDRG, fine. A square RDRG and then we have CGB plus CDB, CGB plus CGS. It's a cross product. No, I think one thing I've done a mistake. It's not CGB, it's like CGD. Looks like CGD, but it's there is no CGB in the circuit. So while doing this one, I made a mistake. It should be CGD. Here also the same mistake I've made. It's CGD. We are going to the circuit. We have CGS, CGD, and CDB. So there is no CGB, in fact. So CGD, fine. So this one is CGD. And this one is also CGD. Right. So we have CGD, CGD, CDB, CGD, CGS, fine. So now I can, okay. Now I can put it over here, CGD. Looks like B. Anyway, so now if you just multiply these two terms, I mean SRD, CGD, SRD, CGD with SRD, CGD, then obviously this gets cancelled, this S square terms gets cancelled. So anyway, but apart from that, we do have a cross multiplication. And so what we have is this S square is having a coefficient like, obviously RDRG is there, RDRG is there. And apart from that, you do have the cross multiplication. So out of these four, already one is getting cancelled, the CGD square, but CGD, CGS, and CDB, CGD, and CDB, CGS. So what I can do is I can simply write like C, C dashed, where C dashed is given by CGD, CGS, plus CDB, CGD, plus CDB, CGS. That means all the possible products of these three capacitors, CGD, CGS, and CDB. So that is nothing but C dashed, and which is multiplied with RD and RG, and this is the coefficient of S square. And then we do have the coefficient for S. So the coefficient for S is, here we find GM, RD, RG, CGD. CGD. And here we do have this term that is RT into CGD plus CDB plus RG into CGD plus CGS. And then we have this one outside. So ultimately now we are in a position to represent this overall gain as a function of frequency in this form. Still, we can have some arrangement over here so that it looks nice. And it is having some resemblance with the second method with which we will probably be discussing in the next class. So anyway, so what I can do is, let us take a look at this particular term, that is this one, GM RD RG CGD. And obviously this one, CGD into RG. And this one, CGD into RD. So from this three term, what I can do, I can rearrange the things. Obviously, this RD into CDB plus CGD can be, anyway, I think that part can be just get rid of. Anyway, if I just take these two together, that will be important. So then that can be written like ultimately minus GM minus SCGD gets multiplied with RD. And already we have got the coefficient of S square, that is RD RG C dash, where C dash is the cross multiplication of the three capacitors. And then as far as the coefficient of AC is concerned, I am in a position to express in such a way so that it is meaningful, or it is easier for us to understand whenever we do the second approach of analyzing this frequency response of a common source amplifier. So what I'm interested in, I can simply write this entire expression like 1 plus GM RD times CGD plus CGS, and this entire thing gets multiplied with RG, and plus we do have this term RT into CGD plus CDB. That is the coefficient of S, and then this one is there. So these three terms, RG into CGD plus CGS, and this GM RD RG CGD, so that can be represented in this way, 1 plus GM RD into CGD, so plus CGS multiplied with RG. So we have RG CGD plus GM RD RG CGD and RG CGS. So these three terms are being represented in this way, and this is left as it is. So there is a typical reason for representing this one by means of this particular expression, or in this way. So now, since we are in a position to represent the transfer function of this amplifier in this fashion, then what I can do is I can closely relate this transfer function expression is H of S, which is nothing but this V out upon V in as a function of S, or rather it will be better if I make a proper naming, like V out is upon V in S. So H of S, which is nothing but V out is upon V in S, which is the transfer function of the common source amplifier. So now we have represented this in this particular form. We have represented it as NS upon DS. So this is the numerator polynomial NS, and DS is the denominator polynomial. And as you understand, the roots of this numerator polynomial will give you the zeros of the transfer function, and the roots of this denominator polynomial will give you the poles of the transfer function. Now, as you have seen in the expression itself, you do have one zero, because if you just equate this part is equal to zero, then you can find out the expression for the zero frequency that can be easily obtained, like GM upon CGD. When S is equal to GM upon CGD, then obviously this will give you a zero frequency. And in the denominator, you do have a second order a polynomial in S. Then obviously that can be represented as the product of two first order polynomials. So this one can be represented like this DS denominator polynomial can be represented like in this form, that is 1 plus S by omega P1 multiplied with 1 plus S by omega P2. So what is the reason behind this kind of representation? Because if you represent the denominator polynomial in this way, then you can clearly identify the different node frequency. I mean, this omega P1 corresponds to a particular pole frequency, and omega P2 corresponding to another pole frequency, and these pole frequencies are coming from the corresponding time constant at two different nodes. One is coming from the input node, and the other one is coming from the output node. And if we can represent this DS in this particular form, then it will be easier for us to visualize the entire thing without going into the analysis. So what I'm trying to mention is, DS can be represented like 1 plus. So now what you can do is, you can write like S into 1 upon omega P1 plus 1 upon omega P2, where omega P1 and omega P2 are the two different pole frequency, plus you have S square upon omega P1, omega P2. So that is the entire thing. Now, what I can assume that out of these two pole frequencies, omega P1 and omega P2, one of them is larger and the other one is smaller. So if I assume that this omega P1 is larger, or omega P1, suppose omega P1 is small with respect to omega P2, if I assume that omega P1 comes first and omega P2 comes next, then omega P1 is smaller than omega P2. If I assume this one, then this expression, in this expression, this 1 upon omega P2 can be neglected with respect to 1 upon omega P1. So now we are in a position, or we are trying to make a resemblance of this frequency response, what we have calculated just now, with the pole zero representation of any transfer function. So if omega P1 is assumed to be less than omega P2, and obviously the value depends upon this condition depends upon the individual value of the capacitance and all. Now, if that is true, then we can simply write down that that can be approximated to 1 plus S upon omega P1 plus S square upon omega P1 into omega P2. And otherwise, what I can do is I can simply find out these two together, this omega P1 and omega P2, separately, because the actual value of omega P1 and omega P2 has to be calculated on the basis of the values given over here. So until and unless you know anything about the individual values for the CGD, CGS and all, then it is very difficult for you to comment regarding this one. So if this assumption, if you assume that omega P1 is less than omega P2, then you can simply neglect one of these capacitors, factor, then this S upon omega P1 can be simply related to this entire thing, which is nothing but the coefficient of S. But now let us take a look at the coefficient of S first. What we find over here, we find that the coefficient of S coefficient of s is, as I've already mentioned, 1 plus gm times rd times cgd plus cgs, all gets multiplied with rg plus rd into cdb plus cgd. Now it is very easy to write it down without looking into this expression once more, because whenever I'm writing this coefficient of s, so I'm just thinking about the small signal model. And if I very briefly, I mean, over here, if I I can also go to the next slide. Okay, I can also go to the next slide. Anyway, so if you can remember the two nodes, we have let me just very quickly go into the second mode of analysis. Anyway, let me just show first, and then I make them inactive. Gm times V1, where V1 is this potential, plus minus V1, and we do have this capacitance between drain and the bulk CdV, and we do have this resistance, preferably RD. We have just now considered only RD, and remember that we do have a capacitor over here, that is CGD, connected between input and output. And if I just consider the Miller effect, then you can simply identify the effect of this capacitance at the input side. So what about the effect of the capacitor at the input side? The Miller capacitance over here. So this is, as you know, 1 minus A times CGD. And the low frequency gain for this common source amplifier is given by minus Gm times RD. So it is equal to 1 plus Gm times RT times CGD. And what about the effect of this capacitance on the output side? So as you understand, it is nothing but 1 minus A inverse into CGD. And since A is large with respect to 1, so 1 minus A, this entire thing, 1 minus A inverse can be approximated to 1 only, because A is large with respect to 1. So A inverse is very, very small with respect to 1. So then it gets equal to CGD only. And that is also applicable for BJT amplifier. You have seen that there is one capacitance that is CMU. It was called CMU, the base to collector capacitance for a common emitter amplifier, which is connected between the base to collector terminals. So we have to find out the effect of this CMU at the input side. It gets multiplied by Miller magnification by 1 minus A. However, at the output side, you will find that the same CMU is coming. So anyway, so you have CGD, the effective value over here, CGD, and the effective value over here is 1 plus Gm RD times CGD. So now we have to do this nodal analysis, to find out the pole frequency, one at this node, at input node, and the other one at the output node. How to do that? To find out the nodal analysis so that we can find out the approximate behavior of the circuit itself, then we have to find out the time constant in each of the node. So how to find out the time constant? So whenever you do have some independent source, voltage or current, so that has to be made inactive. So it should be grounded. And you have to find out the equivalent resistance from this node to ground, AC ground, and the equivalent resistance, equivalent capacitance from this node to ground. Now, the input side, if I take a look over here, what about the RC? The input side, effective input time constant, that is nothing but the resistance. What is the resistance? Effective resistance. This is nothing but RG. So the effective resistance is RG. And what about the capacitance? So the capacitance is nothing but, as you know, the 1 plus gm times rd into cgd plus this cgs, because this is coming in shunt in parallel with the cgs, so obviously it will be added. So effective capacitance is nothing but 1 plus gm rd times cgd plus cgs, and effective resistance is rg from this point to the ground, this node to ground. So you have to travel all the signal nodes, and accordingly you have to find out the corresponding time constant. So once you get the time constant, RC time constant, and then the corresponding node frequency can easily find it out. It is nothing but the omega frequency. If I consider this omega frequency, angular frequency is nothing but 1 upon this RC. And if you'd like to find out the hertz frequency, once again this omega frequency or radian frequency has to be divided by twice pi. So that is the input RC, what you have observed over here. Now what about the output RC? So output RC, to calculate this one, the output time constant at this node is, once again you have to find out the effective resistance. What is the effective resistance here? Effective resistance is RD from this node to ground, and what is the effective capacitance? That is CdV plus CgD, because these two are coming in parallel path, so it will be added. So for output side, you do have RD times CdV plus CgD. So these are the two time constants, and accordingly you can find out the corresponding omega, that is the pole frequency. So the pole frequency omega p1, omega, or rather omega p in, I should say, this omega p in is given by 1 upon rc, and omega p out coming from the output side, or rather I should write rc in, and omega p out is given by 1 upon rc out. Now with this understanding, now if you just take a look at this expression, what we have just now obtained over here. So let us take a look. So the if I want to represent the denominator polynomial in this way, that is 1 plus s upon omega p1 into 1 plus s upon omega p2, then the denominator polynomial is nothing but a polynomial, second order polynomial, having the coefficient of s square, having a coefficient of s and 1. Now whatever the coefficient of s is nothing but the 1 upon omega p1 plus 1 upon omega p2. So essentially these are nothing but the summation of the two individual time constants, input time constant and the output time constant. So I can readily write it down, this expression, without looking into back, without looking back the previous slide, because I know that what about the omega p in. So if I can remember the small signal model of the circuit, then I know that, okay, RG is the resistance from this point, this node to ground, and the effective capacitance is given by this Miller magnification, 1 plus gm rd times cgd, plus we have cgs. So this is the effective capacitance, 1 plus gm rd times cgd plus cgs, and gets multiplied with rg. So the first term, this will give you, so let me mark it over here. So this is coming from the input time, input side, that is rc in, and this is the rc out, rd into cdv plus cgd. So in fact we have received this, I mean we have calculated the same thing. So that is the reason because of which I was very much interested in arranging the terms in this way. Then you just take a look at this. So s multiplied with 1 plus gmrt into cgt plus cgs gets multiplied with rg, that is the input time constant, plus you have rt into cgt plus cdv, that is output time constant. So input time constant plus output time constant, that's all. And you have this s square part, so that is fine. Now if from the calculation, if you see that some of the, I mean depending upon the corresponding value, individual value, one of the pole frequency can be very large with respect to the other. For example, here as you see, if we just compare these two time constant, here you see that if I assume that RG and RD, they are comparable in nature, and these capacitors, they are also comparable, CGD, CGS and CdV. But you find that this RC in is much, much higher as compared to RC out. The reason is that there is a Miller magnification, magnification by a factor of GM times RT. So therefore, you understand that RC in is larger with respect to RC out. So if you are going for rough calculation, so that the exact expression I have already derived, but if you are going for rough calculation, then this RC in, obviously, this RC in is much, much larger as compared to RC out without knowing the individual value. Just by intuition, I can say that RC in is much, much larger as compared to RC out. because there is a Miller magnification. If I assume that all the resistance and capacitance they are comparable in nature, then RC in is much, much larger as compared to RC out. And it suggests that 1 upon omega P in, 1 upon omega P in is much, much small as compared to 1 upon omega P out. So under this condition, you can simply ignore one of them. But if you are accurate, then obviously you should not reject any of the terms. So we have identified two different pole frequency, one corresponding to the input time constant, and the second one corresponding to the output time constant. So now it's time to do the final task, that is to draw the frequency response over as a function of frequency. So as you know, this frequency response will give you the indication about how the circuit performs whenever you change the frequency from very small one to very large one. So this will be the, say this is the frequency axis, and this is the say mod of H, that is the magnitude. And as you understand, initially the frequencies, I mean, for low frequency, the gain is pretty large and it is constant, that is GM times RT. So then those capacitors which are there in the shunt path, in the parallel path, so they will be inactive. So all of them can be treated to be open circuited. So whenever you are operating at a very small frequency, because the impedance provided by those capacitances are very large. So in the shunt path, you can just neglect their effect. Interestingly, there is no capacitance in the series path, unlike a bipolar junction transistor. So remember that for bipolar junction transistor, the low frequency response is primarily limited by the coupling capacitor. But in this case, we don't require any coupling capacitor because the gate is isolated from the channel itself. So we don't require any such coupling capacitor. So the low frequency response for this MOS amplifier is pretty good as compared to the BJT amplifier. So now, initially, whenever you are operating at a very small frequency, low frequency, then this gain is large, and I can consider to be equal to GM times RT. That is fine. So now, as the frequency approaches towards the first pole frequency, that is omega P in, because already I mentioned that omega P in is, I think I have made a mistake over here. RC and omega P in. So this is the relation. So it's not, the reciprocal, because RC is inversely proportional to omega P. So since RC in is greater than RC out, so omega P in, it's not inverse omega P in. So omega P in is small than omega P out, right? Because RC is just the inverse of omega P and vice versa. So, obviously omega P in will come first as compared to omega P out. And whenever you do have a pole frequency, and if you just, if you can remember the Bode's plot, then whenever the frequency, I mean, whenever the corresponding signal frequency passes through a pole frequency, then there is a decrease in the magnitude by a factor of 20 dB per decade, right? So whenever it passes through this omega P in, so there will be a decaying by a factor of 20 dB per decade. That means if the frequency is increased by a factor of 10, then the magnitude of the voltage gain or magnitude of the transfer function also gets reduced by a factor of 10. And that is the thing. So you have minus 20 dB per decade is minus. Or zero frequency, it will increase by a factor of, so 20 dB per decade. What does it mean? So both of them are represented in the log scale. So whenever we say dB, so that means the amplitude in the log scale. Whenever we say decade, so this frequency axis is also in log scale. So what is the physical significance? Perhaps you know that 20 dB per decade means if I multiply the frequency by 10 times, then the corresponding gain also gets reduced by 10 times. That is the fundamental concept. Because if you can remember, simplistically, I can tell you this H of omega, mod of that, I should write mod, I should, instead of writing mod h, I should write it like mod of h omega, because h is a function of omega here. And so if I write like some constant upon, suppose I'm having only one pole at say omega 1, so say s upon omega 1. So I think this is the h of omega, it's not mod. This is h of omega. Then what about mod of h of omega? If h of omega is given by this, then mod of h omega, that is the magnitude, is given by, you have a over here, or mod of a if a is negative, divided by root over of 1 plus omega by omega 1 whole square. That is the concept. Now, if omega by omega 1, that ratio is much, much larger as compared to 1, then what happens? This can be approximated to like mod of a, then it is simply omega by omega 1. So now, if omega is increased by a factor of 10, then obviously this mod of h omega will also be reduced by a factor of 10. So that is the thing. So it is in the literature, it is told like 20 dB decay per decade. A decade, you know what is the meaning of decade. So whenever it passes through a node frequency, there is a decay. So if I call this as omega p in, so there is so initially the gain was constant, so it is having a slope of 0 dB, or it is having a value of 0 dB, and then ultimately it is having a slope of minus 20 dB per decade. Now it is fine unless and it will follow this curve unless you have encountered the second node frequency, that is omega p out, and whenever you encounter this one omega p out, then additional 20 dB per decade. So now what you can see is, I think I can redraw the circuit. You can redraw the circuit to some extent. Yeah, so it is something like that. Suppose this is minus 20 dB, so this is minus 20 dB per decade. And now whenever you have encountered the second one, the second node frequency, then the corresponding decaying will be even more faster, and then it will decay at a rate of, say, so then this is another node frequency. So let me just mark it down over here. So this one is omega p out. And once again, now this decaying is like minus 40 dB per decade. That is fine. And apart from that, you do have in the actual expression, you do have one zero. One zero is existing at GM upon S, GM upon CGD. So you do have another zero frequency, and the zero frequency is existing at S of Z, if I write, or rather, omega Z, the zero frequency is given by GM upon CGD. Now that goal is pretty large, as compared to omega p in and omega p out. And then whenever you have encountered this zero frequency, and whenever the corresponding frequency response passes through that point, and as you know, whenever it passes through a zero frequency, and then the corresponding value of the mod of h omega will increase by 20 dB per decade. So now it will follow this slope. So previously it was like 0 dB, then there is a decaying of 20 dB per decade at a rate of 20 dB per decade, then another additional 20 dB per decade, so then it becomes like minus 40 dB per decade, and then it will follow this one, this 20 dB per decade. So whenever it encounters the next one, then it will be like this. So this is an approximate kind of representation. No, if you know the different, I mean, this one is omega z. So if you know this pole, I mean, this note frequency, this omega p in and omega p out. So if you know this pole frequency, then it will be easier for you to identify or to have some understanding, to have some knowledge regarding the overall behavior of the circuit. But remember, if I just follow this this analysis, the second analysis which you have mentioned, just by observing the corresponding nodes and finding out the time constant, then we did not have any clue regarding the zero frequency present over there. But if I follow the exact calculation on the small signal model, then obviously you have got the zero frequency. But in this particular case, you find that the zero frequency is obtained at a very high value. So as long as the high frequency behavior of the circuit is concerned, so we are least bothered about this zero frequency, because already the signal, I mean the gain, gets attenuated to a very small value. So this omega z is not at all important over here. But you cannot have any idea regarding omega z unless and until you follow the small signal model analysis. But still, just by using this pole frequency model, so just by using this RC time constant, just by considering the RC time constant at the input node and the output node, you have some idea regarding the what about the corresponding pole frequency, and using the concept of frequency response, you can have some idea, you can have some understanding regarding the behavior of the overall frequency response of the amplifier itself. So with this, I would like to conclude today's discussion on the frequency response of a common source amplifier.